cowboys for Jesus, working the range, spreading the gospel, we'll never complain. Though the days may grow long, we'll strive harder to be all the cowboys for Jesus should be. On the wide open prairie, through the day and the night, we'll carry the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Like the clear stars in heaven, or the desert so bright, we'll have a roundup with the gospel of light.
Good evening, and it's good to see you. And the Lord bless you, and I pray you have a good evening. We got a little delay on something, so I'm going to fill in a song, and this is called Granny's Gonna Run. How many of you are one of those grannies or one of those grandmas or one of those? I'm a meemaw myself, but, you know, you can be a granny tonight. And we got a promise one day we're going to get up and run. I don't do a lot of running right now, but one of these days, Terry is. And we are going to, Granny's going to run. So this is for you. Just enjoy, and we're glad for what God does for us, aren't we? Well, Granny's getting older with each passing day, and it takes her a lot longer to get up after she prays. And even though she's aging, her better days aren't done. When Granny hears that trumpet sound one day, ooh-hoo, Granny's gonna run. Well, Granny's gonna run through the gates of glory. She's gonna find her Lord and King. She'll be shouting on the throne with Grandpa, dancing on the golden streets. Her youth renewed like an eagle in the presence of the sun. Well, Granny may be old and feeble, but one day, ooh-hoo, Granny's gonna run. I believe she could do it, don't you? I believe she can take him. Sometimes it takes her a couple of tries just to get out of her bed. And one day in the twink of your eye, she'll be out of there. So don't feel sorry for her. Granny's gonna be okay. When she hears Jesus call her home, you better be ooh-hoo out of her way. Well, Granny's gonna run through the gates of glory. She's gonna find her Lord and King. She'll be shouting on the throne with Grandpa, dancing on the golden streets. Her youth renewed like an eagle in the presence of the sun. Well, Granny may be old and feeble, but one day, ooh-hoo, Granny's gonna run. Listen to this. Well, it's a bird, it's a plane, it's Superman up high. No, wait a minute, it's Granny flying through the eastern sky. Granny's gonna run through the gates of glory. She's gonna find her Lord and King. She'll be shouting on the throne with Grandpa, dancing on the golden streets. Her youth renewed like an eagle in the presence of the sun. Well, Granny may be old and feeble, but one day, ooh-hoo, Granny's gonna run. Granny's gonna run. Granny's gonna run. Y'all give her a hand. This is Gran, and this is Cobe, and they're here to entertain you tonight and to be a blessing. God bless you.
So we're gonna start off with how marvelous, how wonderful, and he's gonna help me sing. Okay. I stand alone in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene.
love for me. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful in my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Is my Savior's love for me.
I could work all my life, never stop to sleep, sing his praises on land and sea. Well, I can't, what to say, excuse me, heard it when he laid down his life for me. Jesus picked up the ticket for me. He died so that we may be free. Even though I'm unworthy, heaven's gates to see, Jesus picked up the ticket for me. Play it. Oh, yeah. Thank you, Jesus. I could spend all my wealth for the work of his church so that others his love might see. But I can't buy the ticket to those pearly gates. Jesus bought that at Calvary. Jesus picked up the ticket for me. He died so that we may be free. Even though I'm unworthy, heaven's gate. Ticket for you and me. Oh, yes. Thank you, Jesus.
Study. We have a good Bible study on Tuesday mornings. We have a good time just opening God's Word and just seeing what He's got for us. And you know what? He's always got something for us. That's always a good Bible study. If you guys ain't got nothing else to do, come out and join us on Tuesday mornings at 7 o'clock, and I know you will enjoy it. Upcoming singers, let's see where we're at. July the 5th, that's next week, right? The Hinkle family. July the 12th will be Doris Merritt. And the other granny, July the 19th will be Rosie O'Toole. And July the 26th will be Rick Gordon again. Prayer request?
I got a prayer, a blessing. We've got some good rain down there finally, and it has made things green up, and we finally got something for the cows to eat. And I'd ask you to pray for my wife. She goes in for a mammogram tomorrow. We'll find out if she's cancer-free. This will be 5 years. In about 3 months, if she's cancer-free, she goes on the transplant list.
All right.
Okay, Terry, we got the results back from the doctor this morning. And they did find a tumor in her bone.
Yeah.
That's what caused it to crack. They're going to send them off to Mayo Clinic for more tests. And when it gets back, I'll know more. I won't get no years this morning or right now, but it don't look good for it quite a while. Don't look good at all. So everybody pray for her, please.
Our prayers of Heavenly Father, we thank you for today, Lord. Thank you for the blessings you've given everyone in here. Lord, there's some that are deeply blessed from your presence, your ability to heal. Lord, I ask we have faith a lot stronger than what we have, Lord. Lord, sometimes we get carried away. We get thinking about things and we forget you. But without you, we're nothing. Lord, I ask that you bless Terry and Rosie. They're such a blessing to the Chisholm Trail Cowboy Church. Lord, I ask that you be with our little singer tonight and both singers. Sing through them, Lord. Yes. Lord, I ask for your guidance. I ask for joy. I ask for peace, Lord. Lord, again, thank you for your love and your grace you've given us all. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
This is called Help Is On The Way. A woman in the Bible days, her last meal almost gone. But God sent Elijah to make his word known. He said, "Woman, don't you worry. God sent me today. And before you even ask him, help was on the way. So just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. A brighter day is coming for those who believe and pray. Help won't help tomorrow if you give up today. So just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way." Aren't you glad he's a very present help in time of trouble? I can look through this audience and see how many times he's touched a life. He's healed a body. He's raised people up when they were down. God is good and he's faithful and he loves you. Don't ever give up. Look up. Troubles of this life come by and burdens get you down. You think no one is listening. You think no one's around. Just remember what his word says. Trust him and obey. Keep your eyes toward the heavens, 'cause help is on the way. So just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. A brighter day is coming for those who believe and pray. Help won't help tomorrow if you give up today. So just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. No, help won't help tomorrow if we give up today. So just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. Thank you, Jesus, for that help. He is a very present help in time of trouble. Go to the center and hold on. God bless you.
If you got your Bibles tonight, we'll be in Job. Job chapter 1. Beginning in verse number 1. Says, "There was a man in the land of Uz," what a name, "whose name was Job, and that man was perfect and upright, and one that feared God and eschewed evil. Now, I thought, you know, that's a pretty good definition there, that perfect and upright man. So I just run a check through the book, the Bible. You got one of them things on your iPhone. Anyway, I run a scan through there to see if God had ever used them two words together for a person. That's the only place I could find that God used them two words together was for Job. So you know, that just makes me think that the Lord really had to love Job quite a bit. But you know, I believe that God actually loved Job a whole lot. Verse number 2 says, "And there were born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters." That'd be a tad much for me anyway. "His substance also was 7,000 sheep and 3,000 camels and 500 yoke of oxen." So that'd be what, 1,000 oxen? "And 500 she-donkeys and a great household, so that this man was the greatest of all the men of the East." It's a powerful person, wasn't it? "And his sons went and fasted in their houses, and everyone his day, and sent and called for the 3 sisters to come eat and drink with them." So they were having a little party there. They wanted the sisters, so that's all the sons and all the sisters having a party, I guess, there, or having just some enjoyment. And verse number 5 says, "And it was so, when the days of their feasting were gone about, that Job sent and sanctified them, and rose up early in the morning, and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said," listen to this, "for Job said, it may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus did Job continually to pray for them." Do we pray for our kids that way? Ask God to bless our kids? We should. Kids are just like us. We all fail at times, every one of us. None of us don't. I've heard people say, "Well, I don't think I do." Well, the Bible says you do. That's all I can tell you. We all fail at sometimes. Verse number 6 says, "Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. And the Lord said unto Satan, Whence comest thou? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, From going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it." That was a lot of walking, wasn't it? Of course, there wasn't quite as many folks back then. "And the Lord said unto Satan, Hast thou considered my servant Job, for that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, Doth Job fear God for naught?" He said, Job's got a reason. "Hast not thou made a hedge about him, about his house, and about all that he hath on his every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land. But put forth thine hand on now, and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face." That's what he's telling the Lord. "And the Lord said unto Satan, Behold, all that he hath is in thy power. Only upon himself put not forth thy hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord." Now, folks, that's a man that the Lord loved with a passion, apparently. He loved him. Job loved the Lord. Job prayed every day to the Lord, asked the Lord to protect his kids, take care of them. That's just something we should be doing. Unless your kids are a little different than mine, we need to pray hard for them. Amen? That's just the way it is. Now, as the scriptures tell us, Job was a wealthy man. He had a large family, large flocks of animals, and he was always careful to avoid the evil things in life. Do we do that? Sometimes we walk right in the middle of them, don't we? "And I always remembered to thank God for what he had had. For him, life was good." He had a good life, and the Lord knew it. The Lord told the devil about it. "Then one day the adversary," y'all know who that is, Satan, the old devil himself, whatever you want to call him, "went to heaven to present himself before God with the sons of God. God boasted to Satan about the goodness of Job. Satan told the Lord that Job only was good because God blessed him. But, and Satan bragged, said, if you'll just leave him alone, give me permission to punish him, then Job will turn his back on you and curse you. Can you imagine that conversation between the old devil and God? God then allowed Satan to do what he wanted to do with Job, but he forbid Satan to take his life or to harm him. Now then, listen to this. You want to know how quick Satan can work? I've heard people say, well, how quick can Satan work? Let me tell you here. He can destroy your life. In the course of one single day, Job received several heartbreaking messages. He was told that all of his livestock had been stolen or killed. Didn't have any livestock anymore. His servants were all dead. And his 10 children were all dead. See, Satan knows there's a whole lot more ways to hurt a man than to kill him. And a lot of people in this world know the same thing. There's a whole lot of ways to hurt a man versus just killing him. Killing him sometimes is just out of his mercy, and Satan knew that. Satan was free to do whatever he wanted. The Lord let him say, oh, you got free reign. But out of all of that, there were only his wife and four servants, I guess, left that I could count. Four servants came and told him about the different damages that was happening, and his wife was still there. They were the only ones that, they were all the ones, I guess, that brought Job the bad news. That'd be horrible news. The scriptures tell us that Job took it hard like anybody else would, like we would all have taken it hard. But look at what verse number 22 says. Job 1:22 says, in all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. In other words, he did not blame God for any of it. He knew where it come from. Satan. He's an evil dude, and he don't care what he does to you. It would be hard to even imagine that something like that could happen. All of your possessions, one day, gone. All of your workers, your helpers, one day, gone. And then worst of all of your children that you love so much, all gone. And all this happened all at one time. How would or how could you respond to something of that magnitude? It would be just impossible. I don't think any of us could survive it. I couldn't. That'd be horrible. Do we have to survive it? Yeah. Do we have to let it happen? Not necessarily. The day before yesterday, I got a call from a pastor friend of mine in Rosie. He's out in West Texas, way out in West Texas. Rosie and I have had the privilege of ministering at his church for a long time, off and on. We were just good friends. We're really still good friends. But he called me. What he told me was his wife had been diagnosed with cancer. He said that over the last couple of months they'd been running tests, and they found out in the last 2 months the cancer's in her bones, in her lymph nodes, and just pretty much, well, all over her whole body. Just in the two-month period, they found all that out. Folks, that's a heartbreak. I can just imagine my wife, and I'm sure you could imagine your wife having to go through that. Come December, they'll have their 50th wedding anniversary, and I pray the Lord will let them have that. I really do. The pastor and his wife are great people. They pastor church, minister to people, and just like Job, they love the Lord and love to work for him. When the tragedy hits us, the same question always, always comes up. Why does the Lord allow things to happen to his children? Those that love him and work for him. As you can remember, a similar thing happened right here in our church. Caleb, just all of a sudden, Lord took him home. What was he, 17? Something like that. Can you imagine, 17 or 18? It's hard. The Bible makes it clear that being a born-again Christian does not guarantee you a good life. Do I need to repeat that? Nowhere in the Bible does it guarantee you a good life. What it guarantees you is you have a good eternity. Amen? And we got a fantastic eternity. The truth is sometimes really bad things that do happen to really good people. Reality is God allows us to suffer at times, just like he allows us to do all sorts of different things that we do. He doesn't stand there and say, you do this, you do this, you do this. So he allows us to do all kinds of stuff, some of which probably we shouldn't be doing as Christians. Thank you. You know that's true, isn't it? So all those that didn't say amen, you'll just go to the mirror and look in and then you say amen, okay? Because we all do it. We're all human. C.S. Lewis, who watched his beloved wife die with cancer, put it this way. But pain insists upon being attended to. God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks in our conscience, but shouts in our pains. It is his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. You know, the bad thing about it is, unless you're just really close to somebody, we just kind of ignore the rest of the world, don't we? We really do. He also said, a needle may be necessary to prevent disease or infection. Nobody welcomes or enjoys the injection, but it prevents a far greater suffering. Did you get that one? Folks oftentimes ask, well, why does God allow things to happen that destroy the lives of people that love him? I mean, if we love him, why would he allow something to happen that destroys him? I can only tell you one thing. I don't know. You don't know either. Why? Because he hadn't told us that. But one day we'll find out. In John 16:33, Jesus said, these things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulations. He tells us right up front, in the world you shall have tribulations. This is Jesus speaking. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. If we belong to Christ, one day we're going to go be with him. Are we going to have our pains and our sufferings and stuff in this world? Yes, we are, unfortunately. Does it make us happy? No, it don't. Well, what will we do? We love them and pray for them. That's what we do. We've all been given free will, every one of us. We can do what we want. It's our choice what we do with our life. Sometimes we make bad choices. That's just a fact of life. Sometimes we make bad choices. And they may not be some big sinning bad choices. It's just bad choices in life. And we get ourselves in trouble. Sometimes things just happen. In today's world, there is illness, abuse, broken relationships, betrayal, sorrow, injuries, disappointment, heartaches, crime and death, and many other things we could think of, because I run out of thinking things up. But there's a lot of stuff there. You could put it there. There's a whole lot of that stuff in this world. Does God do it? No. Does God do it to punish us? No. God loves us. Does God want us to get back to him sometimes? Yeah. He might kind of give us a gentle nudge every now and then. You know, say, hey, son, you're off the path. Something similar to that. But he doesn't hurt us. He loves us. And perhaps you've been asking the same question that everybody else does. Why? Why me? Why now? And folks, them are real questions that ought to have a real answer to it, but I don't have one. You don't have one. The why question is not a new one. It's gone back thousands of years. You can find it in Job, the chapter we've been talking about. You can find it in the writers of Psalms. Look at all the horrible things that goes on in the world today. Just think about it. Look at all the horrible things that could go on tomorrow. Think about it. But you know what? God is still on the throne. We still have to live for him. We have to serve Him. Are we heartbroken? Yes, we get heartbroken, big time. Why? Because we love Him. But folks, sometimes we can't help Him. Do we cry and mourn and everything else? Of course we do. We're human beings. That's what we do. But, you know, all the horrible things that happen, you know, there's still a loving God out there. He doesn't do it to them. The world does it to them. Sometimes, unfortunately, they do it to themselves. We never know. But God knows, and God's still on the throne. The same question always comes up. Why do bad things happen to good people? Anybody got an answer? So look at John 16:33, the last part of that verse again. It says, in the world ye shall have tribulation. It's plain as day. But be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. I want you to know that God is still in control. He never lost control, never will lose control. He is still in control. He's never told us that we will not have troubles in this life. As a matter of fact, He's told us that we will. All we've got to do is read the book. But you know what He has told us? That the story of this world is not over yet. One day He'll write the conclusion, it'll be over. Now, we don't know. It could be tonight. It could be tomorrow. Maybe years from now. Maybe our kids and kids and kids. I don't know. That's God's territory. The Bible tells us that day will come when sickness and pain will be eradicated and the unsaved folks will be held accountable for all the evil they've done in this world. The Bible says it's going to happen. No one knows the time. The timing is His. It may be that He just gives us another chance to get somebody else saved. That's the way I look at it. He's given us another day to witness to somebody. Ask them if they know the Lord. Tell them about the Lord. You know, that's our job. That's what we're supposed to be doing. Some do it sometimes. Some do it all the time. Some do it good. Some do it bad. I never was a great witnesser. I love to talk to people about the Lord. I love to tell them what the Bible says, and I hope each and every one of you all do. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse number 9 says, the Lord is not slack concerning His promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering. Long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all. I like how Bill says it. And all means what? Oh, yeah. Y'all heard Bill say that? That's all. Anyway, Romans 8:28 says, and we know that all things work together for the good to them that love God, to them who are called according to His purpose. Folks, God loves each and every one of us. Always has, always will. The day we were born, He loved us. The day we lie, He will still love us. Does that mean we're going to all go to heaven? No. We're still going to have whatever we've got to do coming. But God loves us more than anybody else did. One of these days, though. And you know, actually, the way the world is looking, it may be real soon. Who knows? The Lord's going to come back. He's going to tell His son, He said, okay, that's enough. Bring my kids home. You know what? We're going to be gone. Boy, I hope all of our kids are with us. Our neighbors, our loved ones. Are you ready for that? When that thing arrives, when that day arrives, I pray you're with us. I really do. Are you ready to meet your Maker? As bad as all life is sometimes, the worst thing you'll ever in your life ever go through will be if you die unsaved. Fact of life, that's going to be the hardest thing you ever went through. I can't imagine what that will be. Once you understand that you are a sinner, just like the rest of us, we're all sinners, saved by grace. Do we still sin? Yeah, probably. We're human. We're always going to make mistakes. We're human. Do we try not to sin? Yes, Okay, so y'all, that's a yes answer. We're always trying not to sin, right? Yes, that's good. Once you understand you're a sinner, all you got to do is ask Jesus for forgiveness. And now, if you don't understand that you're a sinner, what are you going to ask Jesus for? If you don't know all them questions, answers, just ask me. Ask somebody that knows the Bible. Romans 10:13 says, for whosoever. That's who? All of us? Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's really that simple. Sorry, my glasses were getting to bother me a little bit, but they're good. Thank you. I would have had a really hard time looking like this all the time. But God's good, isn't he? He loves us. And if you don't know the Lord, just... actually, there's people all over this church could tell you how to be saved. But I would love to tell you how to be saved. I'd love to just sit down and talk to you. While this singing's going on, I'll be sitting up there somewhere. Just sit down and talk to me. If you're out there on the internet or in Enid on the TV, call me. I'd be glad to talk to you. God loves you, and I really think time is getting short. But he really does love us. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your word. Father, your word is powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword. Lord, your word draws, but your word also repels. But Father, I ask you to just draw anybody in this building that's not saved. Lord, just touch their hearts and make them see that they need to be saved. The time may be short, that you love them, that we love them. Father, I ask you to bless the singers as they sing, dear Lord, that such your perfect will be done for the rest of this service. In Jesus' precious name we ask. Amen. Okay, I want to hear some singing. I do.
Sing along with us. Everybody knows this beautiful song, The Precious Old Rugged Cross.
To die for you and me from God sent down his only son from a cradle to a cross, a victory from sin was won. Perfect love. Savior loved us all the while. They placed his body in a stone vault, just awaiting its decay. But the King arose in victory. He broke the chains of death away. From a cradle to a cross, God sent down his only Son. A victory from sin was won. Perfect love and perfect wisdom came to save man's soul from loss. He fulfilled his destination from the cradle to the cross. Perfect love and perfect wisdom came to save man's soul from loss. He fulfilled his destination from a cradle to a cross, that lowly cross, oh yeah.
Praise be to our God. Okay, we're going to do How Great Thou Art, and everybody sing, please. Belt it out. Praise the Lord. Don't be afraid.
Great thou art, how great thou art.
Thank you all for singing. Here we go.
Science says the ice swept across the land and sculpted the mountain peaks. I believe the touch of the master's hand created this masterpiece. God made the ocean, the sun, and the stars, and every little crevice and crease. And I believe the one who made Venus and Mars made the mountains his masterpiece. Well, science says that man came from monkeys and apes and developed as time went by. The Bible says that God made us from the dust, and I believe that God doesn't lie. Amen. God made the oceans, the sun, and the stars, and every little crevice and crease, right though. I believe the one who made Venus and Mars made the mountains his masterpiece. God made the ocean, the sun, and the stars, and every little crevice and crease. And I believe the one who made Venus and Mars made the mountains his masterpiece. Oh, yeah. Amen. That's what I believe. Nobody can tell me any different. I come to the garden alone. All the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, not other has ever
First off, thank you so much for having us out. We really, truly do appreciate it. And God bless you all. I hope each and every one of you have a blessed day and a blessed week. Cob was born, and when he was born, they said that he would never walk or talk or have any kind of cognitive ability. And, you know, through the grace of God and his miracles, Cob used music and his faith to break down every barrier that was ever put before him. And I get emotional when I talk about this because he taught himself how to walk, and he taught himself how to talk, and he taught himself how to play music. And, you know, Kobe and I use music as the common thread of communication. And what that does is it helps to break down those barriers and remind people that through God, anything is possible. And you don't dare judge people. You know, it says in the Bible that you take the plank out of your own eye before you take the splinter out of your own eye before you look at the plank in somebody else's. And I tell you what, that's a great lesson, and one that both Kobe and I, throughout our lifetime, have held close to our heart. And so I just want to thank each and every one of you, as on behalf of his mom and on behalf of Kobe, thank you so much for coming out and let us share our music. And I'll tell you what, give it up for Rosie and Judy. I'll tell you what, they are some of the best women that I have ever had the grace to meet. And they have the Lord so deeply embedded into their heart, and it comes through in when they sing and just in the way they carry themselves. And as a woman of today, I want to say thank you that I have been blessed to meet both of you. So God bless y'all.
Everybody sing. Don't ever let a day go by without thinking of the name of this song, Blessings of the Day. You can look outside and you can always find a blessing. Very small or very large, he gives us blessings every day, every hour of the day. I wrote this in 2007, and may it bless your hearts. Look for a blessing. When you leave, when you get up in the morning, look for a blessing. I breathe the gift of life as I wake from restful sleep, and I realize he gave me another day to praise his blessed name.
that road of sand, and I thank him for the blessings of the day. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Watch the morning light roll away the night.